Good morning, church. Let's stand together. Let's put our hands together. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Our rock, the only solid ground. The nations rise and fall, and kingdoms once strong now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus.
Name of Jesus.
We trust the name of Jesus. 'Cause you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious.
In you alone. Sing unmasked, there's no one like our God.
Unmasked in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow.
We wait upon you.
We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
He is our living hope. Let's lift him up.
Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. 'Cause you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Victorious, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are victorious.
In the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue confess that he is God, to the glory of God the Father. So let's lift up a banner of praise this morning to the only high King.
We lift our banner high. We lift the name of Jesus. From age to age you reign. Your kingdom has no end. We lift our banner. King forever,
sing it out.
Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious.
Give him praise this morning. Amen. Lord. Lord Jesus, the victory is yours, the victory over sin and death and shame, defeated on the cross. And that's the reason we sing this morning, is because we've been given this grace that results in joy, that results in praise. And so, Lord, we thank you so much that we have the opportunity together as your people who have been bought and redeemed to sing your praises corporately together, to lift up the name that is above every other name, the name of Jesus. And so we want to do that this morning in spirit and in truth, God. We thank you that you meet with us every time we come before you. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated.
I'm Pastor Zach Papuga at Calvary Phoenix, and I want to invite you to this year's Zona Men's Retreat. The goal of this year's camp is to get guys away from their busy lives, connect with one another, create deeper relationships, dive deep into God's word, and have a bunch of fun up in the mountains. So I want to invite you to this year's Zona Men's Retreat, the weekend of April 29th, 2022. And of course, we're going to be up in Williams, Arizona at Lost Canyon Camp. Whether it's the zip line or the rock wall, the coffee house or the frisbee golf course, this camp has a little bit of something for everyone. And this year, we're proud to announce that we've invited Vince Miller, the founder of Resolute Men's Ministry, author of many Bible studies, to come and share with us about the life of David. And he's going to be doing a series called Being God's Man. The cost for this incredible event is only $160, and that includes your lodging, all of your food, and one of these amazing Zona Men's t-shirts. If you're looking for a gift to give your husband, your father, or your son, the Zona Men's Retreat is a perfect gift that will impact their life for the rest of their life. If you're interested in the Zona Men's Retreat, go to azsbc.org/men. I'm so excited about this year's retreat, and I can't wait to see all of you guys there this spring.
Good morning, church. How are you? Good to see you. Hey, grab your bulletins. A couple things that I want to bring to your attention. One, as Pastor Zach was saying, we have our men's retreat coming up, Being God's Man. And I just want to tag on to what Pastor Zach was saying. And I know a lot of you guys are new, and I know, every week faces I don't recognize, some that are coming back still from COVID, some that are just checking the church out. And maybe you've been here for a long time and you have, there's this phenomenon that happens in church where you've been around so long, but you don't know everybody's name, but it's crossed so long that to now ask the person's name would be uncomfortable and embarrassing. Do you know what I'm talking about? It's like your gym friend that you've known for 35 years, but you don't know their first name because it's just too awkward. Can we admit that that's sometimes at church where we don't even know anyone's names? Listen, these opportunities are a great time to shrink church and for you to get close with guys and for you to make connections where you do know people's names. And more importantly, they know your name. Because when people know you and when you know others, there's so much more accountability. There's so much more spiritual development that can happen when church is much more than just coming and going, but it's also coming and being known and fellowshipping. So I want to encourage you to really make a priority to go to this retreat. Be a great, great chance for you to connect with a bunch of guys, sit under great teaching, and have worship. And as you saw at Lost Canyon, if you've never been there, it's an amazing, amazing camp. Also, another great opportunity for us is we have our Miniature Love Our Schools Day event coming up this Saturday on March 26th. And we have now another opportunity. Moon Valley reached out to Andrea, our outreach coordinator, and they were basically sharing that they are so understaffed with their maintenance and the janitorial staff that just simply cleaning their classrooms is something that they desperately need. And so now they're really kind of just hesitant to ask because they're embarrassed, but they've just let us know, hey, listen, we can't even clean our classrooms. We're so understaffed. And so we're like, hey, We'll take care of it. That's what the church is for. So we now have now another team that we would like to assemble with a bunch of volunteers where all you need to do is just go into Moon Valley and you'll be just cleaning classrooms and just blessing students, knowing that, again, we're just helping to propel these teachers and these faculties into just a season of refreshment and encouragement, knowing a church like Calvary is behind them 100%. So make sure you sign up. That is, again, this coming Saturday. This is a great opportunity for us to be together and to serve alongside one another. Because listen, when the world sees a united church outside of these walls serving for no other reason except to say, hey, we love you. Hey, we've got you. It makes such a difference. Amen? So make sure you are a part of that event. And listen, if this is your first time at Calvary, thank you, one person. You can keep clapping. You stuck in there. You stuck in there with that clap. Well done. You just make it happen. Now that was worth it. Listen, if this is your first time at Calvary, we would love for you to make sure on your way out you connect with our Guest Connect counter. We want to give you a small gift for saying thanks for stopping by and worshiping with us. It's a 365-day daily devotional written by our senior pastor. Just a great way to just to bless you spiritually throughout the week. So, hey, listen, let's stand together. I'm feeling it. I want to pray. Lord, I just thank you for this church. I thank you for how awesome of a church we have here, for all these faces that are here, people that are here to seek you, to get to know you through worship and through the teaching of the word. And I pray that as we worship, as we open up your word, I pray that the walls would come down out of our hearts and that you'd speak to us in a powerful way. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Hey, turn and say hi to someone and let's continue to worship the Lord.
The blood of Jesus, not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. And oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood.
It's all my hope.
And this is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And this is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
From the west, as far he's removed our transgressions from us.
He's worthy to be praised. He's washed us by his blood, and we are forgiven and redeemed. Give him praise. Amen. Lord, we thank you so much that we are bought with such a beautiful price, God, beyond our comprehension, the precious blood of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for that grace that allows us to approach your throne boldly in worship.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Welcome home, the sinner now a saint. For the God who died came back to life, and everything has changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Oh, death, where your sting, oh fear, where is your power? The mighty King of Kings has disarmed you, delivered and redeemed. Eternal life is ours. Oh, praise his name forever. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Time. Amen. Please be seated. Lord, we thank you so much for that resurrection power, that same power that raised Jesus from the dead that lives in us. You said that you are the resurrection and the life. That even though we die, we will live with you, Lord, because we put our trust in you. We thank you so much that our song will not change throughout eternity, because what you did on the cross was once and done. It was forever. Payment for our sins, Lord. We don't deserve it, and yet we are so grateful for it. And Lord, we are so excited to spend eternity thanking you for it. In the meantime, here we get to practice. We get to practice through praise and through allowing you to shine through us in our lives. So Lord, would you do that through your Holy Spirit's power right now as we continue to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to invite the ushers forward now as we continue to sing to our King.
Sing your praise.
This song is forever yours. A thousand hallelujahs and a thousand more.
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we have entered into your gates with thanksgiving, into your courts with praise, and through the Holy Spirit, we've offered this sacrifice of praise and worship. And we know that it is accepted by you, that you are pleased by it. It comes from our hearts. We thank you, Lord, that we have something to sing about. What would we do without you? There'd be no song, that's for sure. We thank you that you are sovereign, that you are Lord of all the nations, that you are in control of this world that seems so out of control right now. We think of our brothers and sisters in Ukraine, what they're suffering, the anxiety they must have. Their hospitals are bombed, their shopping centers or movie theaters, their schools are bombed. Lord, they're just at the mercy of the enemy. We pray that you would give them peace. We stand with them in prayer right now. We can't be by them physically, but in prayer right now, Lord, we are with them. And we ask your strength, your power, that you'll give them protection in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray that you'll cover them, that your holy angels will stand around them and guard them. We thank you also, Lord, that we get to come and we get to feast. We get to eat your word. You said that you are the bread of life, and you speak to us through the word, so please do that, Lord. And we can't get the message unless you help us. And so that is our request. Help us hear from you right now. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. Please be seated. And you know, that's a prayer Jesus answers. Lord, help me hear from you. And he's going to go, no problem. Hey, I'm fine. Everybody's asked me, I'm fine. Who knows what was going on, but went through bazillion tests. And the doctor said something that's finally worth paying that copay for. He said, you're great. I said, all right, thank you, doctor. I've known that all along, right? We are in the book of Acts. Maybe some of you are new. Remember those of you who are joining online. So many of you, I just talked to somebody from Minnesota whose family watches every single week, and she's moved out back out here from Minnesota. And you guys are with us every single week. We don't know where people are. Some folks are talking about being in Japan and they would watch the service. There's an outreach here, guys, that goes far beyond this room. So we do pray for all of you who are joining us online. We have been studying the book of Acts, and we have gotten through to chapter 12. We're doing a verse-by-verse study, but pausing sometimes to look at some particular topics that come up. And so I want to go back. I know what have I done? Started 12, verse 1, 3 weeks? I don't know, but I want us to go back and just look at a couple more things. Chapter 12, verse 1. About that time, Herod the king laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. Lots of Herods in the New Testament. This guy was Herod Agrippa the First. Let's just call him Herod, okay? Herod Agrippa the First is harder to say all the time. So Herod Agrippa the First, he had just about anything he wanted. He had all the wealth in the world. He had the power because, you know, he's king over Judah, Israel, Palestine at that time. But, you know, the one thing he really wanted, he could never have. He really, really wanted to be Jewish. Jewish by blood. But you have to be born that way, right? He did everything he possibly could, personally, to make that happen. He was circumcised. He converted officially to Judaism. He obeyed the feasts and the laws of Israel. And yet, He never really was a Jew. Keep that in mind, because this is something that he always wanted, but he never could be there. But he wanted that approval. He wanted the Jewish people to say, yeah, you know, you're one of us. He wanted that kind of acceptance. Some of the things he did are interesting throughout in his history that shows this. One is that it was a custom of kings, new kings in that day, to strike new coins. And usually it would have an image of themselves on it, you know, like Washington or Queen Elizabeth, you know, that kind of thing. Or a god on the coin. But when Herod minted the new coins for himself, there was no image of himself or any god. There were just flowers, plants, because he was obeying the command that says you should not make any graven images. There also was a time when the Emperor Caligula, an insane, cruel, demon-possessed man, well, he was planning on taking an image of himself and placing it in the Holy of Holies in the Temple of Jerusalem. Well, that would have caused a nuclear reaction, you know, among the Jewish people. And so Herod Agrippa the First, he said, he went to Caligula, and it was risky for him to do so, and he talked him off the ledge. He says, please don't do that. It's going to cause a lot of problems. But he interceded for the people. Another thing I didn't know about, but this is how devoted this guy really was to Judaism. The Bible says that once a year the king should read the law, the Torah, to the people. All the people should gather and the king would read the first five books of the scripture out loud. He wanted to do that. And so they built him a wooden platform. He stood up. The high priest handed him the scroll and he started to read from the scroll. Yet we're told that when he came to the verse that said, you shall not put a foreigner over you, he started to cry. Big tears running down his face, because he was what? He was a Gentile still. And yet, this is what the Jews said to him. They said, don't fear Agrippa. You are our brother. You are our brother. He wanted that affirmation. Hey, even though you're a Gentile, you're as close as you can get. That explains verses 1 through 5. Look, about that time, Herod the king, we know about him now, laid violent hands on some who belonged to the church. He killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. See, he was hearing the complaints about the religious leaders concerning this Jesus movement, so to speak. And he thought, you know, they hate him. I'm going to take one of their leaders and I'm going to kill him and let's see what happens. And sure enough, look what happened. Verse 3, and when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he got their favor. That's what he was always looking for. When he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. And this is during the days of unleavened bread. That's during the Passover, about this time in the spring. And when he had seized him, he put him in prison, delivering him over to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending after the Passover to bring him out to the people. But earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church. Maybe put a little X by verse 5. We're going to come back to that. So Peter is treated like, you know, a crazy criminal. He's put in maximum security. I mean, he's chained to two soldiers, and there's two soldiers guarding the door, and he's three gates within the prison. You know, what's up with this, Herod? I mean, he's a preacher. What's the matter? Well, Herod, he knew, you know, these Christians, they have a way of getting out of things. I mean, like, the Jesus they're preaching, he was put in a cell, so to speak, in a stone rolled over it, but he got out of that. And Peter, earlier, we're told, was put in jail by the high priest and religious leaders for preaching Jesus, but the angel of God opened the cell, and he was out preaching the next day. And so Herod said, not going to happen on my watch. And so he puts him in this kind of maximum security over the top prison. But we know what happens. Verse 6. Now when Herod is about to bring him out on that very night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries before the door were guarding the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord stood next to him, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side, and it's almost like kicking, guys. You know, you'd feel it for sure. He struck Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly." And the chains fell off his hands. And the angel said to him, "Dress yourself, put on your sandals." And he did so. And he said to him, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." And he went out and he followed him. And he did not know that what was being done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. This is just a really good dream, God, you know. This would be so cool if this could happen. You ever have a dream that you just wish wouldn't stop? You're really into the dream and then somebody wakes you up. Anybody have that happen? Yeah. Okay. Get back in the story, Mark. Okay, here we go. So he thought he was in a vision. But as they passed the first and the second gate, they came to the iron gate leading into the city. It opened for them of its own accord. And they went out and went along one street. Immediately the angel left him. Well, when Peter came to himself, he said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting." The angel of the Lord rescued him. In the Bible, there's several times when angels of God protect God's people, deliver God's people. With Daniel, remember in the lion's den, the lion kept the angel kept the lion's mouth shut. God delivers through his holy angels. What are angels? They're created beings. And God says they are ministers for us. Man, what a privilege. That they minister for us, who are the heirs of salvation. They'll bring help to us. Remember when Jesus was in the garden and he was crying, he was sweating blood. And after that whole ordeal, it says, and an angel of God came to strengthen him. Have you had these times where you're just so down, just wiped out? And then somehow there's this fresh strength that comes up. Hey, could it possibly be that the Lord has sent an angel? You don't have to be like in this book for the Lord to be. God's still working. Hello? Amen?
Amen.
This stuff hasn't stopped. God still works. And his angels still minister to us. We're not supposed to get focused on the messengers. That's the angels. But what they do is so incredibly wonderful that God would give us this kind of loving care. I was reading one illustration. It was actually a story of a missionary that a Bible expositor that I really respect told, and so I don't think it's, you know, one of those made-up stories. James Montgomery Boyce talks about the Indian evangelist Sindar Singh, who had been witnessing in Nepal and been forbidden to preach in a particular city. However, he went on preaching and was arrested. And this is what he says. They put him in a dry well with a lid on top. He was there to die because they didn't intend to feed him. In fact, Sin was sitting on the bones of people who had died before him. While he was there praying, he heard a noise, looked up, and noticed that somebody was releasing the lid. Soon, a rope was lowered. The rope had a loop in the end. So he put his foot in it and hung on, and he was drawn out. But when he looked up on the top and looked around to see who had pulled him out, there was nobody there. His deliverance, it goes on to say, his deliverance sounds perfectly natural so far as because we can imagine how a sympathetic person might rescue him and then quickly run away so he wouldn't be detected. But when Sin looked around, he saw that the cover was back on the cistern and that it was locked again. So he was pulled out. He didn't see anybody there. When he looked this way, didn't see anything, he turned back and the whole thing's all closed up. Now, that's probably fingerprints of an angel. What do you think? And angels know how to make knots, right? That's cool. I want us to jump ahead now to verse 18. Now, this is the end of that, the morning after when Peter's been discovered missing from the prison. Now, when day came, there was no little disturbance among the soldiers over what had become of Peter. These guys are freaking out because Roman law said that if you lost a prisoner, then you had to suffer whatever penalty that prisoner was going to suffer. So Peter was going to be beheaded. So these soldiers, no, there was no little disturbance among them because if they didn't find Peter, they were going to be beheaded. And of course, that's what happened to them. Don't have any sympathy for them. Look, this is kind of getting off the topic, but, you know, war crimes, people, they'll say, oh, I was only following orders, you know? Oh, I did this, I was following orders, and they knew it was morally wrong, but they're just following orders. You know, and we hear that, and it sickens me. Does it you? I was just following orders. Our commander-in-chief is our Father in heaven, and he gives us moral boundaries that we do not cross. Understand? So I don't feel sorry for these soldiers. You've got a man. This is a man of God. You're going to hand him over to be beheaded. You are complicit in all of this. And I'm sorry that because of Herod's unbelief and the Jewish people's unbelief, it's all causing you to lose your head. But that's how it works. Verse 19. And after Herod searched for him and did not find him, he examined the sentries and ordered that they should be put to death. Then he went down from Judea to Caesarea and spent time there. Now let's fast forward to the end of that year. Now, Herod was angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon, and they came to him with one accord, and having persuaded Blastus, the king's chamberlain, they asked for peace because their country depended on the king's country for food. So for whatever reason, Herod's upset with Tyre and Sidon, so they send their reps, hey, let's have some negotiations here. I'm sure we can work something out because, hey, we are completely dependent upon you for our food. You know, we hear that same thing today going on politically. So verse 21, on an appointed day, Herod put on his royal robes, took his seat upon the throne, and delivered an oration to them. Now, what we don't hear here is told to us by the Jewish historian Josephus that Herod came out in a shimmering robe. It was made out of silver threads, and it, you know, it blinded your eyes almost as he stood there in the Colosseum, the theater rather, of Caesarea, and it was like a human disco ball, probably, you know, something like that. And the crowd then began chanting. I'm sorry. They said, "The voice of a god and not of a man." He's speaking. The voice of a god and not of. Now they didn't think Herod was a god. Maybe they thought he looked cool, but they were just flattering him because what? They wanted their trade agreement to work. The voice of a god and not of a man. But what happens to Herod? Immediately, verse 23, an angel of the Lord, that same angel that Okay, an angel of the Lord struck him down. What is it with this angel? Two times in the Bible, the word struck is used. That word for struck is used with Peter and with Herod. With Peter, we kind of were thinking, oh, Peter, wow. You got to understand, Herod was going to get it too. Peter, it was being struck for deliverance. Herod, the angel struck him to kill him. And how did he die? Immediately the angel of the Lord struck him down because he did not give God the glory, and he was eaten by worms and breathed his last. Oh. But the word of the Lord increased and multiplied. Yeah, you should read about how he died and the theories of how his gut burst and he was full of worms. I was going to get into this with you guys, and I thought, oh, I would love to, you know me, but we really need to cover some different ground. I want you to leave here edified and not petrified. So let's go back to verse 12. When Peter realized that he was not in a vision, basically, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who had another name, which was Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. So Peter thought, well, you know, where am I going to go? And he realized, well, his first preference would be go to Mary's house, because Mary had her big house open for God's people all the time. You know, it's cool. If God's given you a lot of stuff, then let the Lord use it. Share your stuff. You know what I'm hearing? Saying, if you got a big house, then she opened her big house and said, hey, you can have a Bible study in my house. You can have a prayer meeting. She probably had a big place. Maybe her house was where the upper room was, where Jesus had the Last Supper. Maybe it was where the group was gathering for prayer and the Holy Spirit came down them on Pentecost. Some of us think that her house could be that place. So he went to her house where people were praying. And remember, verse 5 says they were praying earnestly, right, to God. Now, this is humorous. When he knocked at the door of the gateway, a servant girl named Rhoda came to answer. Now, can you imagine, you know how it is when you're trying to pray? There are always interruptions, right? You're praying and you're trying to focus, and maybe in a group prayer situation, you try to focus and someone's phone goes off, you know. And nowadays it's not just a ringer, it's songs, right? It's like a hallelujah chorus or something. It's like, okay. Well, this was a knocking at the door. And so you try to ignore it. No. Well, finally they said, Rhoda, answer the door already, you know. Who's there? Get rid of this person. And so it says when Rhoda answered the door, she knocked at the door and recognized Peter's voice. He must have been, let me in. In her joy, she didn't open the gate, but ran and reported that Peter was standing at the gate. And they said to her, you're out of your mind. But she kept insisting that it was so. And they kept saying, it's his angel. They believed that maybe when you died, an angel might appear. It was crummy theology, but not all of theology had been straightened out yet. And my thing, it's his angel at the gate. I mean, does an angel really need to stand outside the gate to be let in? Don't they just do their thing, right? They appear. It's his angel, but Peter continued knocking, and when they opened, they saw him and were what? Amazed. But motioning to them with his hand to be silent, he described to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison, and he said, tell these things to James and to the brothers, and then he skedaddled. He departed, and he went to another place. What a story. Here's a praying church. Now, people often focus on, oh, they didn't have any faith because they weren't expecting Peter to show up. Who says? Where does it say that? Then we read this stuff into the Bible. I don't hear that. I mean, really? What I see is here's an example of prayer. Here are praying believers, and they give us an example. I think they give us four examples. Let's see if we can get through them. First of all, these believers show us that they prayed together. There is power, you write it down, in praying together. Our solo prayers are important. Those are prayers that go up all day long, but when you pray together, and there's so many ways we can do that now. There is power in that prayer. Praying together, man. It's like, Mike, we're coals, you know. Think of the barbecue, and we're coals. And if one of them gets pulled out, it begins to get cool. And you don't start a fire with just one piece of wood. There's several you put together that start the fire. As believers, we need each other. We fuel each other through praying together. And the Lord hears our prayers as we pray united together. If you pray for somebody, it's hard to not like them. Have you discovered that? Yeah, that's right. I'm not praying for them because... Yeah, when you start praying for somebody and it's not the Davidic God, you know, tear them to pieces or something like that. It's you know, praying blessings upon them. It does change your heart. So praying, they prayed, they were praying together. They were praying earnestly. That's the second thing I see. As I've pointed to a couple times, verse 5 says, earnest prayer for him was made to God by the church. Guys, the church used its only weapon, prayer. They didn't have any other. How do you fight the Roman Empire, Herod, Agrippa the First? How do you fight this man? Now, the only weapon we have is prayer, and they used their weapon well. Amen? The church prayed fervently. Now, leave it to Dr. Luke to use this word ektenos, which is related to a medical term. So Luke was a physician, so he's writing Acts. So he uses a medical term here to describe the word earnestly. The word earnestly is a term, a medical term that would be used for when, like, you stretch, you're yawning, and you stretch, and it's like you stretch your muscles as far as it can go, right? That's earnest. Stretching as far as you can go that way. And so it's like their souls were stretched out in prayer to God. Their prayer was not just the, okay, God. It was intense. God, whatever you can do, deliver Peter. Luke describes Jesus praying like this in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was praying and great drops of blood were pouring down on the ground. The believers are praying expectantly. That's the third thing I see. And this is the key to faith. Praying expectantly. We can pray, but if we don't expect our prayers to be answered, they're worthless prayers. So pray in faith, pray expectantly. Now, let's go back. I'm going to show you a little example of this in Mark's gospel. So go to Matthew, Mark, second gospel. Look at chapter 9. A father came to Jesus because his boy had been demon-possessed and nobody could heal him. And The demon would cause him to froth at the mouth and throw himself into the fire to destroy him, or to throw himself into the lake or to water to try to drown him. So this father, desperate father, comes to Jesus. Verse 21, and Jesus asked the father, how long has this been happening? And he said, from childhood. Verse 22, it's often cast him into fire and into water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Okay, what makes you kind of laugh right there? The if. But if you could do something, Jesus. And Jesus, it must have been a little humorous. Jesus says to him, verse 23, if you can, Lord, if you could do something to help us, please do it. And Jesus says, if I can, all things are possible for one who believes. And immediately the father of the child cried out and he said, I believe, help my unbelief. It says he cried out. I believe, help my unbelief. How many times I have believed, but I've had unbelief still kind of nagging me. How about you guys? I've prayed for something and then, you know, Lord, please, but in the back of my mind, maybe the believers there, maybe in Acts, as they're praying for Peter, maybe they're thinking, you know, but delivered, but Lord, we know James got killed. Do you think that might have popped into their mind as they're praying? Of course. We prayed for James and he wasn't saved. Lord, no, I believe, help my unbelief. Now, you don't have to have a lot of faith for your prayers to be answered. The disciples came to Jesus one time and they asked Jesus in Luke, they said, Lord, increase our faith. Give us more faith, Jesus. And Jesus said to them, it's like, boys, if you have faith the grain of like the size of a mustard seed, do you know how small that is? Think a sesame seed. If you have faith that size, you could say to this mountain over there, get up and move, and it would get up and move. What's Jesus saying? He's saying, we're not talking about quantity of faith. We're talking about some people have a hill of faith, others have Mount Everest of faith. He's saying, you know, you got faith? That's what we need. It's the conduit. So you might not have a lot of faith right now, you guys, or whatever is going on in your life and you're praying about, but you've got some, right? Then expect God to answer. Even though your brain's telling you something else, just say, overrule your brain and say, whatever brain, I expect God will answer. Now, I also see that the believers were praying specifically. They were praying for, Lord, please release Peter. When you pray, don't just pray general prayers. Now, I do appear, as I'm saying this, I realize, God bless your church. And God's probably saying, okay, what part of the church, right? So if we ask for general things, we can expect general answers, right? But if you begin to pray specifically, you're going to see God brings specific answers and you'll be able to thank him. The Apostle James says, you don't have because you don't ask. Maybe there's something that God would give you but doesn't because you haven't even asked yet. Ask. Ask for big things. You don't have because you don't ask. But then he also says, some of you don't have the answer to your prayer because your motives are wrong. So always check your motives as you're praying. You're praying for a specific thing. Well, Lord, are these selfish motives? Are they okay motives? You know, God wants you to have good things, so not everything you pray for is bad. Generally, when I'm praying for somebody else, my motives are pretty good, you know, for Lord's healing or blessing on somebody else. But ask specifically, and God will give you specific answers. God, please deliver Peter, they prayed. Jesus taught us, give us this day our stuff. What'd he say? Daily bread. He didn't give the brand, but he said, pray for bread. And the believers were praying persistently, persistently. I guess this is a fifth. When you pray, pray like you want it, all right? Don't pray weak prayers. If you want something, then be tenacious about it. I'm not saying that we tell God what to do, but God wants us to pray earnestly. These people were praying earnestly, fervently, and persistently. Hey, Jesus is the one who said this. He said that he wanted us, in Luke 11, 9 and 10, he said, I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it will be opened. You see the intensity. Ask, seek, and then start knocking, right? Ask, and the Greek is even more colorful. The Greek says, ask and keep on asking. Seek and keep on seeking. Knock and keep on knocking. Don't give up until God tells you to give up. You'll know if the Lord says, okay, son, daughter, enough. This, my answer is yes, or my answer is no. He'll give you that peace. When you come to the point that you have peace not to pray, then stop praying about that thing. Does that make sense? Until then, be persistent, gang. Persistent prayer isn't just, you know, some little brief text to God. It's, God, I really want this. I'm thinking about Peter at the door, you know, he's knocking and knocking and knocking, and they're asking, and they're keeping on asking, and they're seeking, and they're keeping on seeking, and the prayer meeting is knocking, and they're keeping on knocking, and then there is a knocking, right? Knock, 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 and their prayer had been answered. There was Peter. You know, if I could have an angel coach, that would be cool. You guys think that would be neat? You know? We'd each be assigned a coach, kind of like a, you know, somebody in a trainer in the gym who'd help you work out and, you know, hey, that's good. Yeah, you got it. You know, just a few more. Just, you can do a few more. Okay. All right. That's good for today. Now let's move over here. Oh, I don't want to do that. Not leg day. Yeah, it's leg day. Okay. So training you. Wouldn't it be cool if we had a prayer coach? And as we're praying, the angel might encourage us, hey, don't give up. Pray again. You pray that one more time. Come on. You can do it. Come on. Lift that request up to God. Yeah, you can do it. You can. Just one more time. Okay, that's good for today. Okay, now I want you to go pray for this. Not that. Yeah, come on. I'll help you out. Just three more times, and you can go. What if we had an angel coach? How many think that would be cool? Say amen. 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 So if we did, but you know what? The Holy Spirit's our coach. We all have the Holy Spirit. He's coaching us to pray. The Bible says he intercedes for us. He takes our prayers and he makes them, takes what we're praying in and makes it what we really want to be saying to God. He's our coach. You have a prayer coach. And part of what your coach is saying is don't give up. Persist. Because, you know, I wonder how many things we've stopped praying for and we had almost penetrated through the wall, but we stopped just before that happened. Pray through. All right? Or pray to the point that Jesus says, it's okay, you don't need to pray about that anymore. At the end of Paul's letter to the Roman Christians, he gives a string of exhortations, but one of them is to be devoted to prayer, Romans 12:12. Be devoted to prayer. He says, do this, 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 and then he says, be devoted to prayer. When he uses the word devoted, he's borrowing metaphor describing hunting dogs. How many of you go hunting? No judgment. I don't know if you've ever used dogs in hunting, but they would do that, obviously. And the hounds would not stop until they caught their prey, all right? That's the term, be devoted to prayer. The whole idea, the Greeks would know, oh, yeah, be devoted to prayer. Keep chasing the prey until you catch it. Be devoted to prayer. Persist in prayer. Jesus said in Luke 18:1 that we ought always to pray and not lose heart. Not give up. I want us to do something right now, something different. What I want us to do is, we all have the concerns, things that we've been praying for, things that we have been praying for a long time, and as we talk about this message, and I'm talking about persisting in prayer, and being earnest, and having faith, and you're thinking about that thing, Holy Spirit will bring something to your mind there. What I want us to do right now is I just want us to pray for that. Just, I'll give you a few minutes, you pray for that. Just quietly pray for that. But we're gonna start now praying expectantly. We're together praying expectantly, praying earnestly right now. Outstretched, God, I'm praying. Praying persistently, praying in faith. Just close your eyes, don't go anywhere. Just lift whatever that is up to God right now. And let's say, hey, I'm starting now to start praying for that this way. If there's a promise of God that you know about that, then claim it. Tell the Lord, I will not stop praying about this until you tell me not to. Amen. This kind of prayer, you guys, that you've started now, is what you take home. This kind of prayer is a prayer that changes things. You're praying like the early church. And we know several things. We know that if we're asking anything according to the will of God, he will answer that. Might not mean immediately, but he will answer. We have the answer. I was praying with family after the service, last service, and we were praying for one of their relatives and their son, and we were praying for him to draw near to the Lord. Well, I didn't even have to pray, if you can, God, right? I know that's the will of God, right, guys? So we were praying, God, we know you hear this prayer. We know you will answer this prayer. We know it's a yes, because it's the will of God for him to be close to him. And so this is what I sometimes pray as I say, Lord, please do whatever it takes with mercy to bring this person to the Lord or to bring them to their senses. I don't say bring whatever it takes, but always with mercy, God. You can pray these prayers. be tenacious. Somebody gave an acronym that I may have shared with you before. It's the acronym PUSH. Pray until something happens. All right? Just don't stop. Pray until something happens. Father, you love to hear from us. You even put prayer on our hearts. There are so many times when you tap us on the shoulder and you want to talk to us and we get sidetracked or we're kind of saying we're too busy to talk to you. So we want to be responsive now when you say, hey, talk to me. And Lord, we believe, we're praying for each other too right now, for brothers and sisters, that the things that are heavy on their hearts, that they would be given peace and that they would continue with the exhortation to be devoted to prayer, to chase after that answer. We thank you that your people are built up through prayer, that you accomplish your will for some mysterious way through our prayers. And it is an incredible privilege for us to be able to cooperate with you on this earth. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Pray until something happens. That's good. Well, you know what? I got to talk to you about some needs we have. You know, sometimes you've got needs and it's like, it's because stuff isn't happening, you know? And so, but this is because stuff is happening. And it's kind of a momentum thing that's going on around here. We have so many kids coming to kids' ministries now that I've lost my note here. We have so many kids coming to kids' ministry that we don't have enough teachers and teachers' assistants. Is that a good problem to have? Yay! No empty classrooms. They're like, kids are coming and they want to hear about Jesus, and it's like not scary. You know, they're not rabid. You know, they're, you know, you don't have to do any of the hard stuff. Mom and dad do the hard stuff. You teach them a Jesus story and they do something fun with you, and then you just send them away high on sugar. You know, you've given them a snack, and mom and dad have to take care of that. They're hungry at that point, but you don't have to deal with that. You're just taking care of them, telling them a Jesus story and making them happy, and these kids love to come back to church. How many kids have said, I want to go to class? Mommy and daddy will say, oh, let's not go today. And so many parents have said, but our kids, we want to go to class. So they're dragging their mom and dad to church at times. That's cool, isn't it? Our teachers are doing a fantastic job. Make sure parents, grants, or whoever putting the kids in the children's ministry, make sure that you thank the teachers whenever you get a chance. We have needs for our 10th grade. You know, I've lost my note as to where the specific needs are, but Sunday here at 11, we need 3rd to 5th grade teachers. What is that? 10? Is 3rd grade 10-year-olds? Yeah, they're house trained, or they can dress themselves, choose their own clothes. I'm so messing with you. And then we need helpers only, a couple helpers, and a nursing position that is paid, not much. But so these are our needs. It is very little in comparison to what God is doing. So will you help out? Maybe you've done this before. You've done it at another church. You could go to a service here, or you could go to 9 o'clock at the other campus and come here to serve. It's basically you're making a 12-week commitment to help God's kids. So we could really need your help. I'm going to pray specifically about that right now. Father, we can't rustle up help. We don't want to operate in the flesh. And it's your church. These are your lambs. And you said, feed my lambs. We take responsibility for them, Lord. You've given us our children, whether they're ours or somebody else's. And you've called us to disciple these little ones and set them on the track that will lead them to avoid some of the mistakes we've made, and we don't want them to ever have to see themselves. So Lord, here in this church, with those listening, I know there are the people to fill these needs. And so Lord, please move on the hearts right now. We know in our spirit when it's you tugging on our hearts. Move on our spirits to serve you, and we love and look forward to giving you praise as you answer that prayer. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Yeah. You can go to the kids' ministry out front, and you could register, or you can go online and register, or call, or talk to me. Let's stand up. Oh, it's good to be together, isn't it? I want to ask God's blessing on you. Please bow your heads. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance on you. That means smile on you. And give you his peace and his special protection is my prayer for you in Jesus' name. And everybody here said, amen. Amen. God bless you. Turn around and say, have a great week to somebody.